MMTC.
We are thrilled that you are here, and even more thrilled that it isn't snowing in Washington today, as it is usually the case, although I hear it may be snowing in the morning. But welcome so much for being here. It is the 9th annual Broadband and Social Justice Summit. And thanks to you all for making that happen. This is the signature event. As you all know, we always kick it off with the FCC commissioners. And I wanted to have this picture because what a photo of diversity is that. Aren't we thrilled to have an FCC that looks like this room? So thank you all today. I do want to thank especially our friends and sponsors, our gold sponsor, AT&T, BIA Kelsey, Comcast, and the National Urban League, the silver sponsors, Charter Communications and Verizon, the bronze sponsors, MPAA, Netcom, Net Communications, Politic 365, and SNL Kagan, and then our FCC Commissioners Breakfast sponsor, so I know you all really want to thank them, 21st Century Fox, NCTA, Spanish Broadcasting, and T-Mobile. So thank you all to our sponsors. I hope you all will hang with us. We have had a few changes to the program. Some of you all may know that Chairman Reed Hunt broke his elbow, so please keep him in your thoughts and prayers as he goes through that really tough recovery. So we will miss having him with us, but we are very, very excited this morning to start out with the chairman of the FCC, Ajit Pai, who really needs no introduction. But I wanted to tell you all just a couple of things that I've been watching. Of course, you all know how I love to have props with me. So I brought this one. I love it because, of course, I'm from rural Tennessee, and so I always love when I find a commissioner who shares those issues as well. And then the other thing that if you all haven't had the opportunity to read, please pull this up, not during his remarks, but afterwards, and look at this year. This is an incredible list of goals, and my favorite is accomplishments, because we know how long sometimes it takes the FCC, and I will take some blame for that as well, to get something done. So we appreciate so much that this is a chairman who sets goals and then makes sure that those goals are met. He was first nominated and confirmed as a commissioner in 2012, and then has served as the FCC chairman since 2017. I knew him as a general counsel that I valued and trusted, and so we're so glad to have someone like you who has been a champion for diversity, multiculturalism, and all the issues that we share. So thank you so much.
Thank you so much, Commissioner Tate, for that very kind introduction. And good morning to you all. Welcome to the BBSJ 2018. Contrary to what you might be smelling, this is not the bacon, biscuits, sausage, and juice get-together, but rather broadband and social justice. I hope that everyone is highly caffeinated. And I say that not because it is 8 in the morning, but rather because you are about to spend 90 minutes listening to a parade of current and former FCC officials. But all kidding aside, thank you for the invitation. And thank you to MMTC and to its leadership for welcoming me here today. Thanks in particular to the interim president and CEO, Morita Coley Flippin. I don't know where Morita is, in the back. I also need to acknowledge the one and only JJ, Julia Johnson, who is not only the chair of MMTC's board of directors, but also the chief of the FCC's advisory committee on diversity and digital empowerment. As they say, me chairman as Sue chairman. Thank you, Ms. Johnson. I'm also honored to be joined here today by my highly entertaining colleagues at the commission, Brendan Carr and Commissioner Mike O'Reilly. And I understand Commissioner Clyburn is also going to be joining us via video. But most of all, it's an honor to be and a pleasure to be with you today. Yours is one of the most thoughtful voices and the most respected voices in our community. And it is no accident that in my very first meeting as chairman of the FCC, I wanted to include MMTC and discuss strategies for expanding broadband access and extending what I call digital opportunity to all Americans. MMTC, of course, has been a key advocate for many of the policies that we have enacted over the past year. For example, when we proposed to eliminate the broadcast main studio rule, some opponents call this an attack on localism. But MMTC pointed out that the rule's prescribed staffing requirements effectively served as a barrier to market entry for minority broadcasters by putting significant financial burdens on these small businesses. And in the end, your argument carried the day, and we got rid of this archaic rule. MMTC has also been a longtime proponent of creating a new class of FM radio stations called C4. This reform could allow hundreds of Class A FM stations to broadcast with increased power. And in particular, MMTC has noted that this could help small and minority-owned stations gain access to capital and strengthen their foothold in the broadcasting arena. Now, this idea has been sitting around for a while, a long while, before I got into this position. Well, I can now say that it is standing up. I'm pleased to announce that just yesterday afternoon, our media bureau circulated a notice of proposed rulemaking that seeks public input on whether to amend our rules to create Class C4 FM radio stations. As this proceeding moves forward, you can be sure that we'll be looking to MMTC for your insight and expertise. Now, in addition to being a forceful advocate, MMTC has been a formal partner for some key initiatives at the FCC. And I'm speaking in particular about our Advisory Committee on Diversity and Digital Empowerment and our Broadband Advisory Deployment Advisory Committee. I want to spend a few minutes this morning just giving you an update on some of the latest developments regarding these important ventures. I'll start with the Diversity Committee. You know, when I last appeared before you shortly after becoming chairman, the committee was dormant. It hadn't been active for years, and I thought that that should change. And so I decided to reconstitute it, to recharter, to give it some new life. And at the time, I said that its chief mission would be to develop recommendations on how to empower disadvantaged communities and accelerate the entry of small businesses, including those owned by women and minorities, into media and other digital industries. The committee would also be charged with examining ways to ensure that disadvantaged communities can benefit from the opportunities made possible by next-generation networks. Well, that at least was the vision. How is the reality looking as of February 2018? Well, we kickstarted the new Diversity Committee last summer, and we were able to assemble an outstanding leadership team. As I mentioned earlier, the committee's fearless leader is the MMTC board chair, Ms. Johnson. With Julia at the helm is Vice Chair Diane Sutter, the president and CEO of Shooting Star Broadcasting. And beyond that, we have assembled an all-star team of professionals with an extraordinary depth of industry knowledge, who are serving as chairs of the three working groups. Former FCC Commissioner Henry Rivera, now of the Emma Bowen Foundation, Heather Gate of Connected Nation, and Mark Morial of the National Urban League. Now, rounding out the committee, we have representatives of public interest groups, civil rights organizations, trade associations, and the communications industry. And we are deeply indebted, and I am personally grateful to these experts for volunteering their time and their commitment to public service. So that's a team, at least. What exactly are they working on? Well, working on a lot. They are gathering data, they are examining industry trends and practices, and they are considering both industry-based solutions and targeted regulatory or legislative solutions to respond to the challenges that have been identified by the committee. And we've organized those efforts around three working groups. The first working group is the Digital Empowerment and Inclusion Working Group, led by Heather Gate. It is tasked with identifying new ways to expand access to emerging technologies in underserved or underconnected communities. And this group will also recommend ways to ensure that disadvantaged communities aren't denied the benefits of the digital revolution, including economic, educational, healthcare, and civic participation opportunities. This working group may also offer recommendations on how to encourage supplier diversity for small, women, and minority-owned businesses. The second working group focuses on diversity in the tech sector and is led by Mark Morial, As a former resident of New Orleans, he will always be his honor to me. This group is studying the underemployment and the lack of promotion opportunities for minorities and women in the tech sector, which is a serious problem, particularly at some of the best known tech companies. And this working group is looking at ways that businesses can address these issues. And to that end is working to identify best practices of industry leaders with respect to diversity in the tech field. Finally, we have tasked the Broadcast Diversity and Development Working Group, led by Henry Rivera, with finding ways to encourage diverse voices, including minorities and women, in the broadcast business. Now, among the proposals it is studying is an incubator program. This working group is also charged with studying how to promote diversity in ownership and management, as well as in broadcast-related procurement suppliers. Now, I'd like to take a moment to discuss the Broadcast Incubator Program in greater detail. It goes back a long way with me. It's been a personal priority since my unsuccessful push for this program in 2014. And I know that MMTC has been fighting for an incubator program for far longer than that in order to boost station ownership for small businesses, including those owned by women and minorities. The concept here, of course, is simple. An incubator program would provide an ownership rule waiver or similar benefit to a company that helps facilitate station ownership for a qualifying entity. For example, in exchange for a defined benefit, an established company could assist a new owner by providing management or technical assistance or loan guarantees or direct financial assistance or training or business planning assistance. There are many ways to skin that cat. Now, even though there's been general support for this, the idea had stalled. Past commissions had failed to take action. That is, until now. Last fall, the FCC finally agreed to adopt an incubator program to promote new entry and ownership diversity. But we recognize that before the program can begin, there are many issues that need to be addressed. And so we issued a notice of proposed rulemaking seeking input on how to design, how to implement this program. We want to develop a record on how best to structure and administer an incubator program to support the entry of new and diverse voices into the broadcast business. The notice asks very detailed questions, things like the eligibility criteria for the incubated entity, the appropriate and qualifying activities, the benefits to the incubating entity, how such a program would be reviewed and monitored and enforced, and of course the costs and benefits of such a program. But ultimately our goal is very simple: to develop an incubator program that will help address barriers to station ownership, such as lack of access to capital and the need for technical expertise, and for these solutions to increase broadcast ownership diversity. Now, I've specifically asked the advisory committee to help us in developing the overall structure and method for implementing this program. I certainly look forward to the committee's recommendations. Now, as I said in November when we adopted the notice, there was a lot of talk during previous administrations about trying to take action to promote ownership diversity. But there was little to nothing done about it. Well, no longer. To borrow from Yoda in The Empire Strikes Back, try not, do or do not. There is no try. Much wisdom in that statement, there is. And so I am determined that, I'm here all week, folks. And so I'm determined that the FCC on my watch will take concrete steps to create a more diverse communications industry. Our work toward establishing an incubator program is a big step forward in this regard. And I encourage your participation as we do this work. Now that said, I'm pleased to announce that we will take the next steps toward this goal on March 27th. When the Diversity Committee plans to hold its next meeting. More information on its agenda will follow, and I hope many of you will attend that meeting and support the work of this important advisory committee. On a different but related note, there's another issue that I'd like to touch on. Several years ago, the FCC looked into a repugnant practice in which certain advertisers would exclude minority-focused media outlets from their ad campaigns through something called a no urban, no Hispanic dictate. For the FCC's part, former commissioners Jonathan Adelstein and Robert McDowell led the charge. And the American Association of Advertising Agencies, known as the 4As, did too. In 2011, the 4As adopted an advertising non-discrimination policy framework and complaint review process for the media industry to follow. For a time, this policy seemed to work as intended. Unfortunately, it appears that, judging from the feedback from various media entities, that the problem has arisen again. And so, once more, the 4A's group is working to end discriminatory practices in the advertising industry. Very soon, the 4A's will be announcing a new policy called Fair Play. It is issuing a charter to its members, asking media agencies and media departments within agencies to recommit to fair and equitable treatment of minority media owners. This updated policy aims, once again, to eliminate the problem of no Hispanic, or no urban, or no Asian dictates in the media industry. And I want to put it on the record today that this initiative has my full support. It is my hope that this new policy will help even the playing field for all minority broadcasters. In my view, at least, these dictates have no place in the American media marketplace. And with that, from media to telecom, I'd like to take a couple of minutes to discuss another group that has been very hard at work this past year and which has benefited from MMTC's partnership. And I'm referring to our Broadband Deployment Advisory Committee, or BDAC. There's no area where the FCC's and the MMTC's missions are more closely aligned than our shared commitment to closing the digital divide. In my view, every American who wants high-speed internet access should be able to get it. To close the digital divide and to make sure that consumers have more competitive choice for broadband, we will need massive private investment. And the plain truth is that there are significant regulatory barriers to the expansion and the improvement of our wired and wireless networks. These barriers are the grit in the gears, so to speak, when it comes to the BDAC's work. This is what they were created to address. Now, like our diversity committee, the BDAC also features multiple working groups. Also, like the diversity committee, MMTC members serve in key leadership positions. Kim Keenan previously and Rick and Thucker now have been the vice chairs of our Removing State and Local Regulatory Barriers Working Group. And just this week, or just a couple weeks ago, rather, this group submitted its findings and recommendations to the full commission. The group identified six barriers that stifle network investment: regulatory ambiguity, discrimination, excessive fees, inflexibility, non-compliance with rules, and local requirements that are overly burdensome. And more important, they've recommended ways to overcome some of these hurdles. For example, they propose creating broadband-ready checklists to set expectations and expedite deployment projects. I, of course, don't have time to go through all the findings, but I will say that this report is a valuable contribution to our efforts to promote expanded availability of wired and wireless broadband alike. So in closing, and I'll leave it to the real stars of the show shortly, but 200 years ago this very month, the great abolitionist and social reformer Frederick Douglass was born on Maryland's eastern shore, just about an hour and a half drive from here. His message, of course, was as piercing as his commitment to justice was strong. And his words and wisdom still resonate today. Take, for instance, this famous statement that some know the value of education by having it. I know its value by not having it. We can easily see an echo of this kind of opportunity gap in the digital age. Those who are on the wrong side of the digital divide are denied the full ability to take advantage of the opportunities the digital revolution has unleashed. Being able to educate your kids, to get high-quality health care, to start your own business, to participate in civic opportunities, and all kinds of other chances for a better life that were unthinkable just a generation ago. Well, I want to change that. And that is why I'm so grateful to MMTC for your counsel and for your advocacy on these and many other issues over the past year. Working together, I am confident that we will bridge the digital divide and empower the millions of Americans who are on the wrong side of that divide to finally become participants in, rather than spectators of, the digital economy. If we do that, we won't just improve their lives, we will also lift a nation. Thank you once again for your indulgence, and I look forward to working with you in the time to come.
The chairman has to get back because, as you all can see, he is very busy. Thank you so much, Chairman, for being here. We are excited about the numerous partnerships that we have ongoing. We are thrilled that our chairman, Julia Johnson, is also another chairman at the FCC, and so thank you all so much. Julia, come get a picture with me. Sorry, one moment so we can all tweet. Thank you all so much. And please do tweet. I've already noticed a few, so I'm trying to work on mine. The next part of the agenda is to hear a one-on-one with Commissioner Mignon Clyburn. Good friend to me personally. We started at our state PUCs together and chaired those and spent a lot of time in front of the Commerce Committee talking about state issues. And at that point in time, federal overreach. Now it sounds like we're talking about the opposite issue per the chairman's remarks. And so with that said, we will hear a little fireside chat. This is only a portion of her full video, so you all can go online and watch the complete video. Again, not during the next session, but tonight when you all get home and want to watch something. So with that, the Honorable Mignon Clyburn will be up in a moment.
Let's start with Lifeline. So Lifeline has been attacked or, you know, I guess criticized as being a wasteful program. And in fact, if you look at the numbers, it seems like it's one of the least wasteful government programs. So can you see a compromise brewing in this once the data comes out and they see that the data really doesn't show that there's a lot of waste, fraud, and abuse? What do you think?
I remain hopeful because that's my natural posture. But if we don't stop, meaning the detractors, really relying on old data and information and having this hyperbolic rhetoric when it comes to the program, that we will never get to a place where the only program that the FCC has that is targeted when it comes to affordability, it's the only program that really meets people where they are. Think about it. Everything else is infrastructure-oriented. Schools and libraries, very necessary. Healthcare, rural health, very necessary. The high cost of Connect America Fund. But Lifeline is a program that directly targets those who have a problem paying, keeping on service month to month. And a program like that that meets people's needs right where they are is a program that deserves to be enhanced, saved, improved, not ridiculed.
Right. Oh, great. So we do totally sync up on that issue. And just to talk about infrastructure a little bit, is the current approach, you know, requiring that only facilities-based carriers be able to be eligible, is that the death knell for Lifeline?
I believe it is, because again, you would get rid of about 70% of the current providers in the program that offer and will continue to offer, if allowed to, differentiation and hopefully more competition. So what we're saying, or what the majority is saying in what has been proposed is the fact that if you are a high margin post-paid provider, that you're the only game in town. And that is not really allowing people to grow to where they are or to where they need to be. Because we're trying to design this program to meet people data and other health and other types of opportunities. And the only way to do that is if they're connected, if they're going to be connected to broadband, if they can be connected when it comes to a really robust mobile service. So if we get away and do away with that option of those opportunities, then again, you're going to have a lot of Me Too, de minimis service, and no one will be improved or enhancing when it comes to connectivity. I think that would be a shame.
And I'm hoping that the commission can do something to encourage, you know, all the carriers, whether facilities-based or not, to actually provide service to the Lifeline
customers. The incentives have to be there. We have to address any longstanding or outstanding issues when it comes to waste, fraud, and abuse. Mm-hmm. That goes without saying. That should be our mantra with every one of the programs that we administer. But this particular program that, again, ensures that someone can dial 911, that that kid in you know, middle and rural America can have a chance at a broadband-enabled services. We need to improve the program. We need to enhance the program. We need to support the program, not tear it down with any weaknesses, again, that might have been passed.
Right. Thank you. So let's talk about net neutrality. That seems like it's a two-letter word.
Right.
Thank you to Commissioner Clyburn. She and I worked a long time together on Lifeline issues, and I'm sure we'll be talking about that again. Now I want to welcome, as the chairman mentioned, the Honorable Michael O'Reilly and Brandon Carr, the latest addition to the FCC, to the stage. Thank you all for getting up early and joining us. Many of you all have had the opportunity to get to know Commissioner O'Reilly, and I did as well, going through the confirmation process as he worked in several of the offices, including Senate Republican Whip Senator John Cornyn, who has championed many of these issues, and earlier as the legislative director for Senator John Sununu. He was then nominated and confirmed in November of 2013. So many years of experience with Congress and with the industry. Welcome, Commissioner O'Reilly, and so excited to spend some time with Commissioner Carr as well. The first time we've really had an opportunity to do this, so I hope you'll be back next year. I will be. And you all, for those of you all who haven't gotten to spend time with the commissioner, he previously served as the general counsel and also as the main counsel to then Commissioner Ajit Pai on issues such as wireless, public safety, and international. We haven't had a chance to discuss that yet, so I will look forward to that. And then he just told me as we were waiting to get started that he also worked with House Commerce, and so we also share many friendships there, and there will be a hearing next week, and you all may want to touch on that as well. I guess I just had a few opening remarks because I knew that the chairman needed to get out of here. I think he outlined some of our partnerships, but amazing what a difference that a year makes from a year ago, and the fact that the tax reform got through, that many Americans have actually seen a reduction and will continue to see a reduction in their taxes. Many of the telecom and media companies were the first to step up and actually announce bonuses for thousands and thousands of employees in this sector. AT&T and Comcast have both announced not only bonuses. AT&T announced $1 billion in investment, and as you all know, many companies have had so much capital sitting on the sidelines that what we all hope is that that is going to unleash more and more investment. As I mentioned, Chairman Marsha Blackburn will be holding a hearing, and I can't even list all of the acts that are presently being considered. There is everything from Leading Infrastructure for Tomorrow's Act, Access to Broadband Act, Communications Facilities Act, Streamlining and Expediting Approval for Technologies Act, Mapping Now Act, Wi-Fi, on and on and on, and the commissioners may want to address some of those. I wanted to salute my Senator, Lamar Alexander, and who is also a colleague of Chairman Wiley's. I wanted to show you all this big and newspaper article that said power broker because the senator has successfully been shepherding the Music Modernization Act, which, as you all know, will also help diverse voices by ensuring that those who are creators, no matter what platform they may be, the music may be streamed on, will be paid appropriately for their creative labors. So I'm pretty excited about that. I hope that all of this obviously will then result in more minority ownership, more minority leadership, and more investment in all of these platforms and technologies. And as the chairman so eloquently put, so that we all have the opportunities of this new digital age and the full promise that communications and technology sectors bring to all of us. So again, I thank the chairman so much for being here. I think he touched on many of the issues that we will want to continue to talk about. He has certainly led, and you all heard and have been part of, the new relaunching of the Diversity Committee, which did kind of go dormant for a period of time. I'm very excited about that. And just wondered if you all might talk about, obviously, your vision in terms of some of the accomplishments in this whole arena of work on diversity and minority broadcasting.
Sure. Well, first, thank you so very much for having me. It's a pleasure to be back here. And thank you to Commissioner Tate for moderating this conversation. So to answer your question, I think the chairman alluded to, and I think it's fair to say, we're in the early stages of that process. And a lot of things are going on at the same time, whether from BDAC to the Diversity Committee. So a lot of that is still developing, and we expect that to come forward in the next many months. But I think the chairman's commitment to the topic is well known. And we'll be looking forward to the items as they materialize.
Great, thank you.
Well, thanks. It's great to be here. I've had the chance to attend this conference many times over the years. It's my first time to participate in this capacity and really enjoying the opportunity to do so. I agree. I fully support the efforts that the chairman has reignited at the commission. I think we're going to make some good progress on these issues. And when I step back generally and think about tech and telecom policy, the lens that I view all of this through is our opportunity to create jobs, to spur investment, and to grow the economy for all Americans. And I think there's a tremendous amount of opportunity and optimism right now. I mean, you have some investments, as you noted, coming back into the space. We're removing some heavy-handed regulations, which will help to get more deployment. And so I'm really optimistic about the opportunities that we're creating in tech and telecom right now.
I love to bring photos. This goes back to being a professor. So the elephant in the room, let's talk a little bit about net neutrality as the Democrats prepare to use the Congressional Review Act to overturn the Restoring Internet Freedom Order. I know that Chairman Blackburn's Open Internet Preservation Act is floating around out there, or some adoption of by the industry, again, some kind of consumer's bill of rights that I know this was very quickly put out by AT&T. So just wanted to get some of your thoughts for, obviously, we need predictable, stable legal regimes at the FCC, and some of your thoughts.
Well, I think the only way to get to the predictable, stable regime you talked about is through legislation, and so I don't pretend to tell the Congress what to do. They tell me what to do. But I think that there are, as you alluded to, a number of different efforts at the Congress to examine these issues and other places to how could we codify some of the principles in a thoughtful way. I feel very comfortable with what the Commission did in its actions in December. And so we're going to see what the Congress does in the next 18 months on the topic, if it's this Congress or perhaps into the next one, and we'll just have to see how that plays out. I think there are some conversation to be had because I think that a lot of the debate on the issue is misguided. I think that there a number of the comments are confusing individuals and the general public and is suggesting that the internet is not going to have all of the capacity that it does today. I think that the structure that was imposed 2 years ago was harmful for the internet and its success for all communities. And I'm excited on what the actions that we are able to do in December and where it's going to go from here forward.
Yeah, I reiterate a lot of that. I think the rhetoric that we saw over this debate was overheated, overblown. At the end of the day, I believe there's a tremendous amount of common ground when it comes to the internet. No one wants to see blocking, throttling, discrimination. The question is, what's the best legal framework to get to that result, while at the same time incentivizing the massive amounts of investment
right.
that we need in this space to get where we want to go in terms of next generation networks. The Title II framework that the prior FCC tried to hang these rules on was not the right approach, either as a legal matter from my perspective, or as a policy matter when you looked at the impact that we were seeing on investment. And a lot of the rhetoric talked about the investment numbers that we saw from the biggest providers, AT&T, Verizon, Comcast, and there was data about the negative impact there. But when you go back beyond that, you know, there's hundreds of smaller broadband providers that are either trying to be the first provider in certain communities or the first competitive provider in certain communities. Those smaller providers were the ones that were hurt the most by the FCC's Title II framework. We saw specific filings from these companies that they would come in and say, I was going to add this antenna site to provide service to this community or extend a broadband line over here. But because of the uncertainty of this Title II framework overhanging it, they pulled back on that. I also think, again, the rhetoric was overblown to say that we are completely eliminating all legal restraints on ISPs, that it's the end of the free and open internet. Obviously, that's not the case from my perspective. One of the things that we've done, as a lot of people here know, is by reversing Title II, it restored the authority of the Federal Trade Commission. And the Federal Trade Commission has a lot of authorities that it can bring to bear in instances where there's agreements to engage in anti-competitive conduct of the sort that people are concerned about when we talk about net neutrality, blocking, throttling, discriminating against certain content and not other content. So again, I think there is a framework in place. I think consumers are going to be continue to be protected. I think the one difference we're going to see is that overhang of that massive regulatory overreach is gone, and so we should see a lot more investment back in this space. So I think it's going to be a really good thing for consumers.
While we're kind of on the subject of Congress, where do you all think we might be with the telecom rewrite? I mean, do you think that there is now the feeling that we need to catch up with where technology has gone and that, you know, the black phone regulation, back to your point, Commissioner Carr, is entitled to, you know, have kind of outlived a lot of where we live in the world today?
Well, again, that's something for the Congress to decide, but having spent a couple of days there, I suggest that it's maybe perhaps a heavy lift given the timing of the year. It's February, figure people are going to go home in August and then bleed into September, October for the campaign cycle. So whether there's a will or a way, there's a possibility of making that happen. I think there's definitely an appetite for the last couple Congresses to do a rewrite. But for a number of reasons, it just hasn't happened, net neutrality being one of the biggest sticking points, and what to do on that particular topic as it relates to all the different things that you could tackle in a rewrite. So I think there is an appetite to do so, and I think that net neutrality could be the train that carries a lot of pieces going forward, but it seems like it potentially could be a tough lift this year.
Yeah, and, you know, to your point, it's like people like Chairman Blackburn who have championed these issues for a long time, and yet she may be returning home to, you know, pursue other things in our state.
Well, I'll leave that to the to the electors of your state.
You know, I'll simply add that we're seeing Chairman Blackburn, Chairman Thune, as you noted, they've all introduced, or members of their committees have introduced, a series of bills that I think are all really good ones, and I think one common theme you're seeing is a focus on infrastructure deployment in the broadband space. And there's a lot of different bills, whether it's the Airwaves Act that's designed to free up more spectrum, Mobile Now, or a lot of the bills that go to the federal permitting and siting process that are in the House and the Senate. I think those are really good bills, and I think they're going to make a tremendous difference. At the end of the day, we need to find ways to streamline our permitting, our approval, and our deployment process, that's going to be one way that we lead, whether it's 5G or fiber. And so I think they're really on the right track with a lot of these bills, and they seem to be very focused on the infrastructure deployment side. I think that's a good thing.
So I'm glad to hear that we may be getting rid of the ping pong that Professor Randy May had described about what's been going on with net neutrality. Commissioner O'Reilly, you are the professor of process, so I have a picture of a shot clock up. And just wondered if you wanted to share with us maybe where your ideas about a shot clock are.
Well, I have a boatload of ideas on process reform at the FCC. It's not a surprise. I probably have about 35 ideas and getting ready to talk to the chairman on some of those things going forward. But in terms of a shot clock, I've been pretty consistent on the topic. I believe that people are due an answer, whether petitioners of the commission, whether the companies that are filing, they are due an answer. They may not like the answer that we necessarily provide, but they are due an answer. And so I believe in providing a timeline for making a decision by the commission. It's something that's been wrapped up into process reform and legislation in the House Commerce Committee, and it's something that's been near and dear to my heart. It's also been something that Chairman Pai has talked about in the past as well. So I think it's something that is due for a review by the commission, and it'll be high on my priority list because I think, you know, after whatever the time frame, and we can disagree on what the particular time frame is on the particular issue, if it's merger reviews or application transfers, and people say, well, it's not 180 days, but it's some other time frame, I'm willing to listen on the exact time frame, but I think that we do have the capability of making a decision in a particular time frame. What I dislike and disagree with wholeheartedly is the idea that we can stop our shot clocks because someone sneezes. It's a bit, you know, something bad happens, something doesn't happen, something, you know, the innocuous happens, and we stop our shot clocks. And I think that's not how the process should work. I think people are due a decision so they can move forward with their business or with their idea or challenge it as they so see fit.
Well, and it's almost like allowing a pocket veto, you know, by one or more commissioners just to kind of stall an issue. And if you wouldn't mind, maybe you want to tell us a couple of those things and we might be helpful as we talk with the chairman as well.
Well, there's a ton of good ideas I think I have, but I'll give you one. You know, I'm trying to figure out the process, and I wrote a recent blog on our must vote process where we, you know, this is the mechanism for the smaller type issues, not those that go in our meeting, but those that circulate amongst the commissioners, and we try to vote on those electronically. And we have a process designed that pretty much can be delay an item for up to about 50 days. It can sit there for 50 days.
50?
50 days. Depending on what day it actually is voted on by the majority, what day it's circulated, and things, but up to 50 days it can sit there. These are supposed to be the most, you know, benign items, and right. I just think that time frame doesn't make a lot of sense. We can shorten that time frame significantly by just waiting periods that are built into the clock that don't deserve to be there. Now, at one time, the creating the circulation process and establishing some time frames made a lot of sense. What we need to do now is review the time frame and shorten it. There's still plenty of time for any commissioner to review those items. I've been on both sides of the equation, the majority and minority. There is plenty of time. If we were to take out, you know, 3 weeks of that process, we'd still have plenty of time to digest the items and still be able to vote on them without, you know, jeopardizing any due process.
Commissioner Carr?
You know, happy to see those reforms. I agree. I'm happy to move more quickly at the commission, reach a decision, and move forward. I think those are all really good ideas.
Excellent. My next one is 5G, and sometimes I think that we get a little caught up in this being new and wireless, and we forget that it also involves a lot of infrastructure. And so I thought maybe I'd give you all the opportunity. I saw in ComDaily an article where lawmakers, industry, others blast Trump 5G proposal to build out a nationwide network that's secure against hackers. And I just thought, Chairman Pai was very open in saying the main lesson is to draw from the wireless sector's development over the past three decades, in that it's the market, not government, is best positioned to drive innovation and investment. So would you all give us your thoughts?
Well, I think that it seemed to be from reading the comments that are in the public that the idea was something very early on in the process, very low level in terms of how it was proposed. It seems, you know, reading the papers, that the individual who wrote it has since moved on to a different opportunity. And so I suspect that doesn't seem like it's something that will move forward. You know, substantively, I disagree wholeheartedly with the idea. that was contemplated. I think it's incredibly problematic. We have an amazing wireless industry that is leading the world in 5G, leading the world, and you know, has developed because of the expertise they've had in 4G. They've done a wonderful job in serving the United States and its consumers, and they've also led the rest of the world in that development. And they're going to continue to do so if we're able to get out of its way and provide the spectrum and resources so they can flourish going forward. So I'm excited on what's coming forward. I think any idea of nationalizing the network or type situation, first of all, being so far down the tracks, these companies have already been developing 5G for a number of years. Standards are being set and being approved on certain components. I think that the idea of any kind of nationalization is not even a possibility.
Yeah, I think when you look back at the history of the U.S. and our deployment with 4G, we led the world, and there's a reason why we led the world. And the government stepped back. It let the private sector invest and innovate. We didn't get involved, unlike counterparts in other parts of the world, with standard-setting process. We let the private industry stakeholders drive that. And again, we led the world in 4G deployment. That's going to be the key to 5G. But 5G is also something else. It is going to require, as we've talked about, a lot of investment, $275 billion by one estimate. The network is going to look very different, 10 to 100 times the number of cell sites we have today, in addition to many, many miles more of fiber and other high-speed connections to connect all those devices. And as I've traveled the world in this job from Buenos Aires to Brussels, there's a focus around the world on leading in 5G. A lot of countries in Asia, Europe, South America are very focused on this. But the key to leading in 5G is not, you know, pounding the table and saying we're going to lead in 5G. The key is how quickly are you going to reform and update. This is the challenge for regulators. How quickly are you going to reform and update your regulatory structures? Because again, that 4G world of one macro site that serves 30 or 40 miles, that's not going to be the world for 5G. And so if your regulatory structures are still designed to process that type of deployment, you're going to get left behind in 5G. And that's why we have a number of proceedings at the FCC right now where we're looking to get 5G ready, where we're looking to update and reform our infrastructure rules. And I've been spending a lot of time the last few months in the record with our wireless infrastructure proceeding and thinking about next steps in that proceeding. And hopefully in the next couple weeks, I'll be able to talk more openly about what my ideas are there. But I think we're getting close. And that is going to be the key to leading in 5G, is streamlining those infrastructure deployment rules, everything from environmental to historic to state local. And I'm confident that we're going to get that across the finish line this year. And that's how we're going to give our private sector the best shot at leading the world in 5G, is by doing our part in reforming our regulatory structures.
Well, just know that MMTC wants to be a part of those. So when you're ready to talk about them, we'd love to hear about them and ensure that you know, indeed includes, you know, multicultural and diverse involvement, leadership at all levels. So thank you. We'll look forward to that. As you all know, I was one of the very few fiscal conservatives to support the Lifeline program, and there has been so much discussion about waste, fraud, and abuse, but I always saw it, as you heard Commissioner Clyburn eloquently discuss, that it was a lifeline, a true lifeline for jobs, for healthcare, for education. Now, teleservices, health services, all kinds of things can be done right on our phones. So I just thought that we would love to hear from you all. We're going to hear Commissioner Rosenworcel at lunch. I know she's going to talk about her homework gap initiative that she talks about a lot, but I just thought, you know, what are your thoughts about how we do in enhance it and improve it, but realize that it has some potential for reaching many people who otherwise would not be part of, you know, the new digital age?
A couple of things. I think I've been here a couple of times and have suggested to you that there are many within my political party who don't support Lifeline and would like to see dismantling of it. I haven't been of that mindset. I've been one who's tried to make the program work. I would have preferred, before we expanded the size of the program, before we did some of the reforms last commission, that we examine the waste, fraud, and abuse issue. People say, well, it's the least fraud, waste, and abuse program in the federal government. Then they cite a number that particularly, but when you're talking about billions of dollars that are coming out of ratepayers, it's our job to make that as most efficient as possible. And when we're doing the enforcement items, we're not seeing the least, you know, waste, fraud, and abuse program going forward. So there are problems with the program, and they're not just things that have already been addressed, even though those fixes are still multi-year away from being implemented. So we've got problems with the program, and they need to be addressed, and I'm full support of doing so. That being said, the chairman has put forward a very thoughtful idea, I think, that it examine how this program should look going forward. And I think that's the part of the beauty of our process is we put the ideas out there and we take comments from individuals. At the end of the day, I want to see a program that fully functional and one that is most efficient as possible, knowing there'll still be people who try to take advantage of ratepayers that generously give their dollars for this purpose.
Yeah, I'd agree with that. Look, there's no doubt in my mind the Lifeline program is serving and will serve in the future important purposes. You can make that statement and believe that as I do, and at the same time recognize that there's waste, fraud, and abuse in the program
right.
that we need to take care of, and we can proceed on both tracks. And we have a proceeding open right now where there's a range of different ideas that are put out there about how do we reform this program going forward. And, you know, I'm happy to look at the thoughtful comments that people are putting in that record and make our decision about the best path forward.
Great. Well, we thank you all for your leadership and support. I wanted to give you all an opportunity just to talk about maybe an issue or a topic, an initiative that you all are extremely interested in. So, Commissioner O'Reilly, anything else that you want to build on or expand on?
Sure. I mean, I talked about this a little bit, or at least alluded to it. It's not also working with Commissioner Carr and his leadership on the infrastructure issues, which I know raised the dirty word that no one likes to say, but it's going to require preemption. It means we're going to have to preempt bad actors in the state, local, and tribal governments. That's not always easy to do, and it's going to be messy, but it's required if we expect to see deployment that everyone would like to happen in the broadband space. The issue that I also spent a ton of time on and working so hard on is making spectrum available to all providers that are interested in the space, not only in the low band that we did as part of the broadcast incentive auction, but I've been spending a ton of time on mid-band spectrum, whether it be the CBRS in 3.5, whether it be 3.1 to 3.5, or 3.7 to 4.2. So mid-band is so important, not only domestically, because providers would like to offer multiple services there, but also internationally, where you're seeing multiple countries and communities designate that for the next 5G mobile services. And then at the high bands, I've been pushing really hard to add more spectrum bands to the plate. We've identified four for licensed services. We have two more that we're examining, part of our Spectrum Frontiers round number two. And the chairman has committed to me to do a round three this year, hopefully the summer this time. So we'll add even additional bands in the high frequencies for purposes of bringing new technologies to consumers. And so it requires two components. It requires, in my opinion, to get to 5G and your picture that's still there. It requires the infrastructure issue and pushing bad actors out of the way, and requires resources such as spectrum so all providers can offer service.
Fabulous. Commissioner Carr, I know you have jobs initiatives, and I don't know if you want to expand on that.
Yeah, a couple things. You know, as Commissioner Riley pointed out, we're making real progress on a number of fronts. I think this infrastructure side is going to be really important. It's where I've been putting the lion's share of my time. As the commissioner pointed out, spectrum is going to be another key piece of this. We're getting a lot of spectrum into that spectrum pipeline finally. That's going to pay dividends soon. And another piece of it that you mentioned as we look to 5G and these next generation networks is we have to make sure that we have the skilled workforce in place to actually do the deployment,
right.
This massive new deployment for whether it's 5G or fiber or other high-speed connections. And I've heard from providers that say, you know, right now we're facing a skills gap. And I know you have a panel later today that's going to talk about that and talk about the role that apprenticeships can play in closing the gap. I've done a couple of meetings with the Department of Labor. It's an issue that I'm going to continue to work on. It's not one that is within our wheelhouse as a regulatory matter at the commission, but when you look out there at the massive deployment we need, we have to have the skilled workforce to do it, and it's also a tremendous opportunity to create jobs in this space. I mean, 5G deployment alone has talked about the creation of 3 million new jobs. A lot of those are going to be traditional construction type jobs. So I think that's something that I'm focused on, the Department of Labor is focused on, and hopefully you all will hear more about it during the apprenticeship panel later on today.
Terrific. We had the opportunity to talk with Chairman Pai yesterday about the dearth of engineers for AM radio. And so that's one of the other issues that we'll be talking with you all about as well. And we want you to use your platforms. I will just take this opportunity to suggest that publicly, I don't think I'll have to file anything about ex parte if I say it here, that as the national co-chair of the opioid task force for all the courts across the entire nation, we are very interested in the FCC getting involved in the opioid crisis. So whether it's using your platform to try to encourage all communications companies to start educating Americans about the crisis, more people have died during the opioid crisis than during the entire Vietnam War. I'm very concerned because it's hit Tennessee so hard. 6 people die every day. So there is a rural health care fund, as you all know. While I was there, I was a big champion of it. We were only utilizing 10% of that fund then. Now I understand it's being fully utilized, but I hope that you all will see this as a way for the FCC to get involved and speak to this epidemic that's going on across our nation. So I encourage you all using your platforms beyond regulation. Why don't we do a little bit of a lightning round? Commissioner Carr hasn't been here, but this is where you're like, basically, you just agree with what I said. So I know the first one is, I know you all would like to use your platform to get involved and help provide solutions for the opioid crisis. Anyway, the first one is, what, I can't remember, Commissioner Carr, were you able to go to CES? I know that Commissioner, oh great, so tell us one of the coolest new things, because I remember how exciting it was, and I saw some weird helicopter. So anyway, what was the coolest thing you all saw?
You know, I think the progress that's being made on autonomous vehicles is really interesting, just the way cars are being designed completely differently. It used to be, how quickly can a car go from 0 to 60, and now the considerations that we're getting into are, you know, vastly different. How connected is the car? I think that's going to be a really interesting space going forward.
I'll say what, you know, something that's not necessarily, use Commissioner Carr's term, in our wheelhouse. I got to see some drones and see the size of drones, how they've shrunk, and the power, you know, required to use them has shrunk. I think that's going to be very interesting going forward, and the policy issues that they raise.
This reminds me of going out to Boeing and seeing those satellites just fold up. When I saw the size of some of those drones, you know, you just can't even wrap your brain around it. So how exciting. So glad you all were able to be there, and sorry that the chairman was not able to go. The chairman established the Office of Economics and Analytics that will help ensure economic analysis is consistently incorporated across the commission. I took one of my attorney positions and actually hired an economist because I felt so strongly about this. And so I'm glad to see the chairman realizing that often, this kind of goes back to the whole net neutrality discussion, often we're not making decisions based on mathematics or economics, but we're making them based on policy and politics. So with that said, I'd love to hear, have you all been involved in this new office, and how will you be able to utilize them? Are the commissioners going to have access to them? Just interested to hear.
Sure. So I spent a ton of time on this issue, and I would say, excuse me, it's not just something that the chairman realized. It's been something he's advocated for a long time, such as I have as well. And we made 2 big pushes of the chairman, and he was gracious enough to accept. One was making sure that the role and the stature of the new office was of such prominent level that it was treated within the agency, you know, and its cost-benefit analysis that it does, and the process in terms of signing off on particular items. So its role within the agency is of sufficient value that it can't be ignored. The second function that we spent a great deal of time on is making sure that it's not just about this commission and this chairman who's really open to these issues and really focused on them, but it's making sure that it's long-lasting. How do you ingrain it into our process and put it into our rules?
Yes.
So it's not the next chairman, but a couple chairmen from now maybe have a blind eye to economic issues, and we want to make sure that this process and this structure exists long after we pass out of here. So I've definitely been involved, and I think it's key to making sure that our decisions are justified and reasonable.
Great.
Yeah, I fully support the decision. I think it's heading in the right direction. I was frustrated during the last commission, the last administration, with a lot of the so-called cost-benefit analyses that were being done. It felt more like a hand wave than an actual analysis, and you dig behind it, just even some of the basic math would be wrong. We have to go back and forth with people on that. I think this new office is going to help a lot. to go back to my time when I served as general counsel, that's how I view a lot of what the Office of Economics is going to be. The general counsel's office serves as sort of the legal conscience of the building. It's a separate, independent-ish body inside the commission. You're not necessarily in the day-to-day fight of driving towards particular policy outcomes. You get the item, you get to step back, take an objective look at it and say, yeah, you can do this, no, you can't do this. I think that's a lot of how the Office of Economics will play. Hopefully they'll also be involved, and I think structurally they are going to be involved, early in the process as well, but it's giving them that sort of office, that identity inside the building that can push back and over a long term make sure that we're getting the best information we can. And again, it's not necessarily outcome determinative. We can make the decisions that we think are in the public interest, but this will be a key piece of making sure that we get to the right results.
Commissioner O'Reilly, did you have anything else to add?
No, I think
okay. Great. Let's talk a little bit about privacy issues. Last year, Congress actually passed a resolution that a resolution of disapproval about previous broadband privacy regulations, and the FCC has promised to work with the FTC to ensure, and this kind of goes back to something I think that Commissioner Carr said, to protect consumers' online privacy rights and through some kind of consistent and comprehensive framework. So just interested to know, are you all trying to work together? Have you set up any kind of cross-agency relationship? Just interested to hear your thoughts.
Well, part of this, I think, again, ties back to the broader net neutrality debate. In 2015, when the Commission classified broadband as Title II, it completely stripped consumers of the privacy protections that were being enforced by the Federal Trade Commission. It created a donut hole where there continue to be protections for consumers relative to edge providers, and there were essentially none on the rule side that protected consumers with respect to ISPs. We've now fixed that problem by restoring the Federal Trade Commission's authority, and any effort to go back to Title II again would create the donut hole once again and strip consumers of the strong privacy protections that the Federal Trade Commission has in place today.
I would say it this way. There are a couple, there's a limitation because of the Congressional Review Act in terms of what we can do. There are things that this is something that, the chairman has authority that we necessarily may not have. And I think the third thing to look at is that, I think the FTC is being reconstituted in some degree. They're going to have five new members going forward, so they're going to get their legs under them in terms of how they want to approach some of these issues. But yes, we are, conscious of the work that our partnership with them on a number of different issues. Here is something that where they can lead and have led in the past successfully. I don't want to treat ISPs different than other edge providers that relate to privacy. That's why I liked and supported what the FTC has done in the past and didn't agree with, and one of the reasons I didn't support our past rules as relates to net neutrality. So I think it's something that goes hand in glove. There are roles and responsibilities that they have, and there's certain things that we have, and we'll continue to have those kind of conversations and dialogue.
I know this may have been the first time that you all heard the chairman say that he was supportive of this fair play concept that the 4As has just put out, but if you all have had an opportunity just to think about the issue, would you tell us your thoughts?
Well, I think I was here a couple years ago and it was raised, and I was supportive then, and the past commissioners that have worked on the issues are good friends of mine. So I think it's something, I haven't been fully up to speed on what the chairman talked about this morning, but I will be momentarily, and we'll take a look-see at it as soon as we can.
Yes, similarly, I've not seen that fair play initiative before, but I'm happy to learn more about it. I think obviously directionally, that's exactly right.
Also, he brought up the new C4, new possibility of FM stations. Have you all had a chance to think or consider that yet?
We just got the item yesterday afternoon, so there's a little bit of pause on that. Look, I have said this publicly in the past. I want to, when the idea was put forward, that there is diverging views within the broadcast industry on this creation, and I want to hear from all sides before contemplating where to go.
Yeah, happy to dig into the item, take a look at it.
You all both have small children, and both Chairman Wiley and I were very, very interested in public television and advertising to children and some of those media issues now that have moved over to other platforms. So just wondered, as dads and parents, if you all could speak a little bit about how you feel about those issues.
Well, I love what public broadcasting does, and we do spend a fair amount of time in my household watching, you know, public broadcasting. We also spend a great deal of time on what you could call cable children's networks. They aren't the traditional broadcast networks, but we do in moderation. My daughter only gets so much time, so much, you know, screen time and so much television time. We try to balance those with other activities. But that which they, you know, we do allow, we want to, you know, make sure is healthy. And what you're seeing is, and I just wrote a blog about this in a couple weeks ago, is what you're seeing is that other platforms, other opportunities are available to parents for such valuable programming. And you're seeing, you know, our old KidVid rules not make a lot of sense. Don't seem to, you know, the marketplace has moved past the existing broadcasters in terms of trying to restrict exactly what they offer at certain time periods and putting a straitjacket on what they have to do, when we find that other platforms that are unregulated are offering wonderful opportunities. So I think it's a ripe time for us to look at our KidVid rules, and I think that's something we're going to have a chance to do this year.
Yeah, I think that Commissioner Riley has shown really thoughtful leadership in this space. I read his blog on the KidVid. I'm happy to see what steps we can take in that direction. I think if you step back more broadly, it reflects this idea that our media ownership rules, for some reason, more so than any other regulatory space of the commission, have languished for years in the pace of technology. Where the marketplace is going has far outpaced our media regulations just across the board, from, you know, random paper filings to media ownership rules, from the big to the small. And I think this past year, the commission has shown an interest in, just like we're updating across the board everywhere else, we got to bring our media regulations forward into this century. And so I support, you know, all those efforts that we're engaged in.
5G for media regulations as well, right? Move from 1G to 5G all at one time. Well, please, go ahead.
No, I was going to say, people ask me why I spend so much time trying to remove barriers and rules that we have as pertain to broadcasters, and I say, because they have the most burdens. You know, they have so much on their plate. Now, for many years, they wore that as a badge of honor, that they had all these burdens, but, you know, they were considered highly regarded at the commission, and so it's kind of this trade-off. Well, the last number of years, they didn't really get the other side of the equation. They just had the burdens, and the past chairman didn't have very good fond memories and thoughts about the broadcasting community. So what we try to do is reflect our obligations under the statute and the current marketplace in removing those barriers that no longer make any sense, and it just so happens that a lot of them on the broadcasting side.
Thank you all both for your thoughtful and practical responses. We appreciate your support. Please join me in thanking the commissioners. We appreciate so much your being here. We'll see you next year. The commissioners' breakfast. Thank you. Chairman Wiley and Mr. Larry Irving, please join us. As I said earlier, we are... Oh, photo. Absolutely. Okay, it's time. It's another Twitter moment. Joya? Sure. I appreciate so much having Larry Irving here to fill in at the very last moment. I don't think either one of you all need an introduction to this crowd, and we went over a little bit because I thought it was important for us all to hear from both of the commissioners about all of those issues. As always, there is so much going on at the FCC all at one time, and the chairman certainly moves as quickly as he possibly can. As you all saw, he had that circulation item yesterday afternoon, which he had told us he was going to do. And so sometimes I think maybe MMTC, this event drives some things getting done, which is wonderful. But with that said, maybe just after hearing both the chairman and the commissioners, you all can just kind of do a little informal. What did you hear that you were kind of most thrilled about, or from your both of your perspectives, is something that you worked on while you were in your leadership positions that you can share with us today?
Well, let me start on that. I have long supported the incubator program. I know David Honig and I have been thinking about that for a long time. I thought the tax certificate was another way to try to get more media ownership relief, and I think that still is up there in Congress someday, maybe. But now we have actual possibility of an incubator program, which I think has real potential. And so I'm excited by what the commissioner is thinking about. Obviously, the details, the devil's in the details. We'll see what the commission comes up with. But the basic concept of having a quid pro quo, helping the minorities and helping the stations get some media relief, I think is great.
Let me start by first wishing that Reed Hunt was here first, but that he gets well fast. I kind of feel like Nick Foles coming in for Carson Wentz. I hope I do as well. And it was Sunday, I was watching the Super Bowl, and I get an email, we finally found you. Can you fill in for Reed? So I'm delighted to be here, and particularly delighted to be here with my fellow Northwestern Wildcat.
Yes.
We're both Northwestern. Were you the same class, or are you the class, one class ahead of me?
You're older.
There, that's right. With regard to what we heard this morning, there are a couple of things that I'm fully supportive of the incubator program, and I'm hopeful that it works well. Having worked on the Hill and having worked at NTIA and having promoted minority owners for years, I think one of the things we have to be very, very careful is that it doesn't become just a dodge, that it doesn't become a front, that it really is buttoned up, and that the folks who are being incubated aren't just a way to get around rules and regulations. And we've seen that happen, and I will assure you that on the left, having worked, and I'll just say it, for both Mickey Leland and Ed Markey, working with Chairman Dingell, there is no greater way to lose support from Democratic members of Congress and the Senate than to have these programs become just another way for folks to expand their universe and put a front out. So if we're not very careful, we don't lock that in, we have a problem. The other issue that got raised that caused me a little consternation, or some agita, I guess, would be the, and there are a number of things, but the thing that at the end was KidVid. I was the staff person who wrote the 1990 Children's Television Act, and there was a reason for it. And the cognitive differences between children and adults are important. Broadcasters have a license, there are things that should be done. And when people talk about all the new platforms for children to watch programming, we need to be very careful. I mean, I went last night, and I went on YouTube, and I saw toy unboxing. And it was one toy unboxing video that had over 5 million children, or 5 million viewers, had gone on YouTube and watched kids open and playing with toys. Now, when you think about what that does, you know, we have very clear commercial limitations with regard to, you know, you couldn't have a Transformer TV show. We limit the number of commercial minutes on programming geared to our children. And yet, on an unregulated platform, we have children watching hours of other children just opening toys. If people don't see that, you know, that's not the direction I think we want to go. And so I think we've got to be very, very careful. Yes, we want broadcasters to be profitable. We want broadcasters to be able to do things. We also have to recognize they have a responsibility to children. And if we just abrogate that responsibility, we're not doing our jobs as either regulators, parents, or citizens.
So I'll put a plug in for those of you who have young children to go on and see what Common Sense Media has. They rate shows across every single platform. They show scientific studies of brain development and why it is important for parents to be the parent. With that said, Chairman Wiley is the father of children's television and a lot of the emphasis on the importance of broadcasters to Larry's point in this whole arena, and that they do have a responsibility.
Well, I mean, the very first speech I made as chairman of the FCC had to do with children's television, that broadcasters had a responsibility to provide some educational and informational programming in addition to just cartoons and things like that. And that really got started with Captain Kangaroo and Mr. Rogers and all those things. And I think that's been a great credit to broadcasting. I think it's wonderful for children as well. I realize all regulation has to be reviewed, and I think that's what Commissioner O'Reilly was simply saying. Take a look at it, see if it still makes sense. I don't see anything wrong with that at all. But I agree with Larry. I think that children are part of the audience, an important part of the audience, and we've got to make sure they're served.
And just really quickly, I'm on the board of PBS, and so if you really want high-quality children's programming, just help put your child in front of a TV, let them watch public broadcasting, and I promise you they'll get nourishment for their mind as better than anything else on. But I also think, you know, one of the things when we looked at PBS's board, we now have a 24/7 kids channel, but we also do things on platforms, you know, the other screens. I think that what Commissioner O'Reilly was saying of limiting screen time is right. And I agree with you, Commissioner Tate, that it is really important that parents be parents. But we also know in these busy times that a lot of parents don't have the time to be as great a parent as they want to, and the children have these tools. So steering them toward the right kind of programming and content, that is something we can do. And we do have a phenomenal institution in public broadcasting, I think does the best job of anybody in terms of providing educational, non-commercial programming for the children of America.
So, with your background as assistant secretary and NTIA, we still have the 5G slide up there, so things have drastically changed, both domestically and internationally, so love to hear your thoughts.
I think this is the most exciting new era. I've been lucky. I've had a chance to be in public policy. We went from the broadcast to cable era, the cable to the internet era, internet to broadband era, and now the 5G era. And the job creation, the opportunity for folks to do amazing things is there. I will go to one issue from my days at NTIA, and it's something we haven't done that I still don't understand. We still as a nation don't have a full inventory of federal government spectrum. I've been on this for 5 or 6 years. It makes no sense to me that we don't fully know where the spectrum is, what its valuation should be. We have not done the hard work we need to do to identify, understand, the economic implications of this spectrum the federal government uses have. I've been saying it for 5, 6, 7, 8 years now, and it still hasn't been done. I was part of the Obama transition team coming in, and right after that transition team ended, I said, we really should have a better sense of what's out there, who's using it, and how they're using it. I understand there's some black box programs, but if we're going to really do 5G, we really have to have a better sense of spectrum, and we're going to have to give some federal government use the spectrum over to the private sector. The second thing I want to say very quickly is I want to make sure that as we rush to 5G and we need to go race to 5G, I thought the nationalization idea was insane. I spent most of the 90s running around the world asking the rest of the world to privatize, to allow for private sector competition, and to pick up a newspaper and see that a Republican administration was saying we need to nationalize kind of blew my head off. And I also, it's going to be interesting when this administration has to deal with municipal broadband, because they've kind of said states and cities shouldn't provide broadband, and they're saying the federal government should own 5G. It makes no sense. I was glad to hear that it's not going to happen. But I also want to make sure that as we go to 5G, we're not looking at 5G as a reason to get rid of needed protections for consumers and completely disavow the environmental and other regulations that might be needed to protect American consumers. We want to get to 5G, but not at any cost.
I think the idea of nationalizing 5G was really not a very high-level concept. And so I think we ought to just say, okay, if somebody's thinking things and bouncing around ideas, that doesn't mean that they're being supported by the president or by anybody in big authority. We've got a great private sector. As Commissioner Carr said, we've led the world in 4G. We'll lead the world in 5G as well. And I think that's the way to go. And I do think the chairman is leading the way also on trying to find other areas of the spectrum high in the area that we never thought could be used, might be able to be harnessed. And I think that's what we need. Continue to look for more spectrum for 5G. And 5G is going to be a great resource.
Yeah, I was fascinated with that as well. I remember having the big spec, and I'm sure you did too, Mr. Secretary, the big spectrum chart. you know, on the back of a wall that I looked at all the time. And here we are finding new parts of spectrum. And back to your point, of course, we know the government has some of the most valuable, richest spectrum in terms of being able to use it for new and innovative services.
So. One of the great things about being Assistant Secretary of Commerce and NTIA, I got to sign that little chart. So somewhere out there, there are still charts with my name on it. You know, I have like three of them squirreled away, and years
great.
From now, my nieces and nephews can sell them for about $1.50. You know.
I love that. So I will ask you all once again about the elephant in the room, and maybe we'll get some difference of opinion between the two of you all. But where do you see net neutrality today, or where is it going?
You know, I really think a great answer would be legislation, because, you know, there really isn't a great difference when you get to the principles of the concepts. We just have to get beyond this Title II concept, because that's something that the Republicans are not going to support, and yet nobody wants blocking. As Commissioner Carr said, nobody wants throttling. It's too bad that we can't get legislation. It probably won't happen in this Congress. I think that's fair to say. We've got to go through the CRA, which isn't going to happen, folks. The House is not going to support it, the President's not going to support it, but politically we've got to go through that process, and then eventually maybe we can get to legislation. I think that's the answer, so we don't bounce back and forth between administrations and where we're going in the whole area of network neutrality. I think it's a greatly, frankly, overwrought issue.
Yeah, I cannot believe it's been a decade of this, and I also couldn't believe that we just couldn't utilize and support Chairman Powell's original set of principles, which basically, in essence, is what this Bill of Rights does. But, Mr. Secretary.
I'm going to go back, and I'm going to agree with my colleague and disagree a little bit. I hated both. I loathed Tom Wheeler's approach, and I intensely dislike, or maybe even loathe, Chairman Pai's approach on net neutrality. I think that going Title II went too far, but abrogating its responsibilities and turning over all privacy to the FTC was, to me, an abrogation of responsibility that is almost unparalleled with regard to the FCC. So I dislike both of them. But I do agree with Chairman Wiley that we need to have legislation. And what's interesting is about a week and a half ago, I was having dinner, and I was talking to a young woman from Senator Snow's office. And Senator Snow had introduced a bill 12 years ago, not just a decade ago, 12 years ago, that was co-sponsored by my former boss, Ed Markey, by Senator Wyden, by then-Senator Obama, and then-Senator Clinton. So clearly there was a bipartisan support for a bill over a decade ago that would have solved this, not doing Title II, would have gotten rid of this morass. And I don't understand why we can't go back to finding a bipartisan approach that doesn't create Title II, that puts privacy responsibility back in the FCC. And the reason I think that's so important is the FTC right now has one member. We don't know the other four members are going to come. And by the way, the FTC usually is like posthumous resolution of issues. You have to actually have a problem and then go to them, and it's a resolution. The FCC has a long, distinguished history with CPNI and others on privacy that we need to restore. So I had a real problem with saying for any federal agency to say, I'm not going to do this. I'm going to give this to this agency. And for those of you who have a do not call issue, think of how well the FTC has done with Do Not Call. And now we're going to give them privacy responsibility for the internet? I mean, that makes absolutely no sense, and yet that's where we are.
Well, I think you're right, Larry. I think if we had legislation, the FCC's regulation and authority would be clarified. The FTC could be in on Section 5 for unfair trade practices, deceptive consumer practices, and I think we'd have the best of both worlds.
That's what we're looking at. You know, you've got a Republican and a Democrat agreeing. I would hope that some Republican and Democrats on Capitol Hill could agree.
Well, tell that to Ed Markey. Okay.
Ed and I talk regularly, and I think he'd the right bill that would have the right protections, he'd be there.
So I don't know what either you all have said or one of the commissioners, or perhaps something I said. Facebook has now said you recently posted something that violates Facebook policies, so you're temporarily blocked. So MMTC has been blocked. So I hope you all So I hope you all go online and let them know that we need to be unblocked.
Can I talk about Facebook for a minute? Because I got a lot to say about them.
Please.
I mean, you
wax
know,
on.
I will. You know, we talk about minority hiring, and it offends me that every year Facebook trots out this same woman who happens to be black, and she explains why they haven't hired any of the black people. I mean, it's like, it is the most insane thing I've ever seen in my life. It's like they've gone from 2% to 3% in 3 years having this woman as head of diversity. Now, Facebook is completely dominated by data analytics. Tell me another vice president, senior vice president, head of anything at Facebook that sees absolutely no improvement in their job and keeps their job. So I am delighted to see that Ken Chenault, I'm delighted to see that Ken Chenault is coming over to Facebook, and I'm delighted to see that Facebook is, his primary focus is on diversity. Because when you look at Facebook and you look at Google and you look at some of these companies, I went to Stanford, right? They're in a community that's 40% Latino, and they can't find a Latino? Like, seriously? Like, how does this happen that they have less than 5% Latinos, they have no Latinos on their board, they finally put a brother on Facebook's board, they just put a black person on Google's board. You know, black women, it's crazy. And when you make the changes, like my good friend Deborah Lee is now on Twitter's board, in a year she has made positive change in terms of the culture and the employment record of Twitter. When you have people in leadership, these things happen. But other than that, I don't feel strongly about any of this stuff. I'm just calm and collected, and I think Facebook knew I was going to say this. That's probably why they blocked us.
Nothing like blocking the voice of a diversity in America, right?
Unbelievable.
So I was just about to ask you all about the rechartering of the Diversity Committee and also BDAC and just your thoughts about the FCC using their platform and their voice.
I think it's terrific, and I'm glad to see my partner, Henry Rivera, actively involved in that, as always.
Absolutely.
And I think Chairman Pai is showing tremendous leadership in that regard. You know, you're going to have a lot of studies, and we now got to get to action, and I think that's what we're looking for, and I think it'll happen. Don't you, Larry?
I think it's important, and you look at, you know, Julia Johnson, Mark Morial, who, believe it or not, worked with me in Mickey Leland's office 30 years ago almost. I mean, we're looking at Henry Rivera.
Yeah.
I was 10. He was no. We're looking at some of the best and brightest minds, and I want to commend the chairman for reconstituting these committees. And I want to commend the people who get taking the time to put their energy and, you know, one resource none of us have enough of is time. And for people to put their time and energy into these important issues is important. So I'm glad that it's happening, and I'm very happy that you have minds that are diverse, that are smart, that are experienced, that are chairing these committees and serving on these committees.
So while we have you here, and because we're talking about spectrum, the commission's historic spectrum auction, barely, speaking of people that aren't moving the needle, barely moved the needle on minority spectrum ownership. It is just such a challenge to increase not on the, only the participation in the auction, which you have to participate in order to be successful, but any thoughts on what to suggest?
Go ahead.
You know, I've been looking at this issue for over 25 years, and I don't have there is no Solomonic dictate that, for, you know, I can't become an oracle and figure out a way to do it. You know, the problem is still access to capital, and it's going to be a continuing problem, and I think we have to look at that issue specifically. I'm open to any suggestions. One of the things, you know, you were going to the principles, and I commend Randall Stephenson for saying that we need a Consumer Bill of Rights. You know, 25 years ago, this month, I was nominated for Assistant Secretary of Commerce, and my first job was to create a set of principles for the internet, for what we call the Information Superhighway. And we lay, if you look at all of the issues now, open access, universal service, open internet, all of those things, there's a document from August of 1993 that a group of really smart people put together and we thought about. We need 25 years later to have a group of really smart people to come together and think about what's the going forward strategy for America? What's the going forward strategy to have people make it a more inclusive 5G? What's the going forward strategy to make sure that broadband, you know, digital divide is something, you know, I'm kind of the father of that term. That was 1995, 96, folks. We're still talking about the digital divide.
Because there is one.
Because there still is one. But if you're rural, if you're a single mother, if you speak a language other than English, if you are a person of color, if you are low income, if you are elderly, you're less likely to have the internet and much less likely to have broadband internet than people who are more affluent, who are white, who are urban, suburban. I mean, we have these statistics. We know what it looks like, but we haven't really sat down and done the hard work. So, okay, we know what the problems are. What's the way to get there? We did that 25 years ago. We knew what we wanted to do, and we went there. And my call for folks is to help from both a progressive and a conservative perspective, think about what's the right way for this government to act and for the private sector to act to solve the problems we know exist. We have 25 years experience, and here's the problem. The divide today is problematic. The divide in 2 or 3 to 5 years is going to be life-changing. There's data analytics right now that they can look at, I can send my information to a doctor, they can look at that and they can tell me whether or not I'm likely to have a heart attack in 2 or 3 years. With Fitbits, whether I'm likely to have a heart attack that week. I mean, these kinds of things, some people have it and some don't. We've got to change the conversation about the digital divide and about all of these issues with regard to diversity. Sorry.
But you've got a chairman now that says his number one goal is to close that digital divide. That's pretty impressive, I think.
Well, that was our number one goal from 93 to 99. Yeah, so, I mean, it's like...
Yeah, but you didn't get it done. Maybe this guy will.
We didn't get it done, but part of the reason we didn't get it done was because people didn't understand how important it is.
Well, it's not easy.
It's not just government. It's got to be the full community.
And you've got to harness the marketplace to make it work in the United States, in my opinion.
You've got to harness the marketplace, and you have to have public policy that allows marketplace players to... address those places the market doesn't work. The market doesn't work for everybody all the time. I mean, you look at some of the issues. I remember when I was going to CES and other places, I'm like, why is it that every commercial is geared toward a white audience? And, why is the content not there for Spanish-speaking Americans? Why are we not reaching out to communities of color with regard? Now, if you look at one of the things I did years ago, look between wireless commercials and look at the difference between computer commercials. Wireless commercials were skewed younger, more diverse. They were looking at the audience that was buying wireless.
Right.
Computer commercials were skewed older and whiter because that's who they thought the market was. You've got to understand that the market works, but it only works if people have a full understanding. How does a company not have any black or Latinos in a country that is, for every 2 children born in America today, one of them will be a child of color? All right. How are you going to create a tech company that doesn't have people who reflect those communities on their boards, in their senior management, and among their employees?
I could not conclude in a more passionate way. So please join me in thanking them for being here. MMTC.